Remember we told you that Matthew chapter 5 through 7 pretty much records what has become known, you know, in the church world amongst theologians, the Sermon on the Mount. Amen? Or what we call the Beatitudes. So we pointed out to you, remember, that I believe, and I think you can verify this as you read the New Testament, that all of the New Testament doctrine is built from what Jesus taught. Amen. Amen. You can say, how can all of that come from a mere few chapters? Well, you know, we don't have all that he said. Amen. So there a whole lot came. One of the writers wrote, if all that Jesus said and did were recorded, the world could not contain the books. Now, we find that impossible to believe, but I'm just quoting what the scripture said. There is a lot he said and did, amen, that was not recorded. But what we do have is all sufficient for our salvation. Amen? When I say all salvation, that doesn't just mean new birth. That means bringing you into the kingdom, growing you up, perfecting you, and making you just like him. Amen? And that's a good thing. So, remember we all told you that the word Beatitudes come from the Latin word, beatus, meaning blessed. Did you know that, remember Jesus made a statement about the little children when they came to him, the disciples kind of tried to shoo them off like dogs. He said, suffer the little children. That really bothered me. Suffer the little children to come unto me. Forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of God. So Jesus took every opportunity to kind of parabolize, you know, a truth for you and I to let us see the simplicity of not only what he taught, but the kingdom. What's my point? My point is that then the Bible said later on he called and he blessed them. He laid hands on them. Well, do you know this is something that has not been I don't think, talked enough in the kingdom of God. Because we don't look at it as walking away with something. Listen, many times when the Lord comes, just like he came in the beginning of the service, I mean, I can tell him when he starts releasing his glory from himself. And the Lord, it is a blessing just to feel the presence of the Lord. I mean, you agree with that? The Lord not necessarily giving you something tangible, so to speak. Because we humans are like that, you know. What do I get out of it? What can I turn this into? You know, what does it look like for me? Well, the Lord is life. I mean, so his presence coming from him is a blessing. So when Jesus laid his hands on the little children, he was depositing them simply a blessing. Not a prophetic word. Not that you're going to be a king or apostle when you grow up. Not giving them a tool per se, a gifting or an anointing per se. Simply his presence. Now watch this. This blessing, it dissipates after a while. Just like the wind that comes and blows and brings everything with it, and then the wind goes. What am I saying to you? You can't live off of a blessing. But a blessing, a continuous blessing of the presence of God, is what you need. No more than you can be sustained for a long period of time after a glass of water. You're going to need more water later on, aren't you? Amen. So how do I move? Now, don't fool yourself now. I'm not discarding blessing. It's good. But that's what most Christians come to church for, not realizing that's what they are, is I want a blessing. I want a blessing. I want a blessing. Well, what are you going to do when the blessing dissipates? What are you going to do? See, the Lord wants to give you something more lasting, substance. Amen. And that's who he is, not what he dispenses. Amen. And so if you come into the reality and receive who the Lord is, guess what? When this blessing comes from him, it is magnified much greater, amen, in the one who is more mature than the one who is not. Amen. I mean, that is evident. You can take a 3-year-old, take a 13-year-old, and hand them both a $50 bill. Who's you're going to get more reaction out of the mature one because they somewhat can understand what this buys. Amen? Now, if you take that same 50 and give it to a 1-year-old, he's going to tear it up. He's going to make a lot of pieces out of it. Amen? So what am I saying to you? Maturity is a necessity, brother, sister. Because whatever you get from God is magnified through your maturity. It's a necessity. And so this is what Jesus taught, what he taught. See, if you want to truly be blessed, then these beatitudes need to become a part of who you are. God is more interested in your attitude because your attitude comes from your motive. So they are kingdom laws. This is what I'm trying to say. They are kingdom laws. So look at verse 9. This is where we are now. We are down now to the peacemakers. Now, you know, one fruit, and not to mention the fact that you don't hear a whole lot about the fruit of the Spirit taught in church. It's not taught enough. That's why we have very little Christ likeness in church, Christ character in church. When I did my doctoral thesis, it was on the character of God, which is the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit, I call the character of God. Amen. You can't make him anything else than what those fruit are. And is it a reason why the Scripture speaks and puts love at the top? He's all those other things, but in his description of himself, it doesn't say God is peace, though we know he is. It doesn't even say God is joy, though we know he is. But it says God is love. Amen? Again, the same principle of truth about blessing, increasing what you are. Brother, sister, if any of the rest of the fruit in your life, joy, peace, long-suffering, temperance, meekness, patience, if they are to grow, if they are to do you any good and go beyond you, which it should, it will not go beyond the degree of love that you're walking in. It will not. Love gives life to all of the rest. It's kind of like this. You can have all the utensils, in your house that you can ever want. Ain't a bit of good without electricity. Huh? Ain't a bit of good. All the tools you need. Stop paying that light bill. You're going to starve if you don't get to somebody else's house. If you don't build a fire in the middle of your house. Amen? See, this is what has happened to the church. We've discarded love. And because we've discarded love, we've tried to have peace, and you can't have it. Come on. When a 3-year-old child and children know that they are loved, they can sit in your lap, amen, a little baby, amen, with their eyes closed, sucking a bottle, ain't thinking about what's going around in the world because they feel secure and loved. We've discarded the most important thing, but our joy, our peace, our long suffering is on life support. We've tried to keep it alive through human reason and feeling. God is not flesh. The fruit of the Spirit is not natural. It is the fruit of the born-again, recreated human spirit. Because God's fruit is not growing. Huh? We are. You ever seen the fruit on the tree? It's not on the vine, y'all. It's on the branches. Jesus said, John 15, I'm the vine, you are the branch. If you don't abide in me, you will not live. What is he? He's love. If you don't abide in love, your fruit is not sustainable. It will fall from you, the tree. And right when you need peace, you cannot muster it up. Right when you need long suffering, you're going to curse somebody out. Amen. It's not sustainable. So you have to abide in love. You hear me say all the time, there's no mystery about it. There's no magic formula. How do you grow in love, preacher? Love. Love. So every opportunity you pass up to love, you take some out of you. You don't put some into you. Amen. And you cannot do it without humility. You cannot do it. Because humility thinks of the other, thinks of the needs of the other. If humility is not a part of your life, right when you need to sacrifice, you're going to think about you. What is it doing to you? And what am I getting out of it? Let's settle this right now, brother and sister. Our birthday party is in the end. Amen. Our birthday party is at the end. So stop trying to have a party every time you look around. Amen. What I mean by having a party? You want a happy time in every event, in every circumstance, in every situation. You want it to turn out right and beneficial for you. You want a party all the time. It's my body and I cry my walk. Huh? You want a party all the time. Sometimes you're going to have to cry to suck it up, to allow humility to flow. Because it ain't about you. It's about the King. That's why he said in John 14, those who love me will do what I say. That's why he said that. Because you're not thinking about me. You're thinking about what he wants. And you want to be like him. I know it was a time that everybody wanted me to be like Mike. You know, they showed his tennis shoes and all of that. I'm not thinking about jumping high and hitting some hoops. I'm thinking about hitting the mark of the high call in Christ Jesus. Amen. So, blessed are the peace thing. This peace thing, amen, we're going to need it, brother, sister, in these coming days. Because we've had a president, amen, whose calling was to take peace from the earth. That's what he had, and that's what he's done. He has done his job well. Well, guess what? The lawlessness that's in the streets, the Antichrist spirit that is dominant in America, is because there has not been the peace in the church the way it should be. Amen. Everywhere, I'm not saying that there will be hostility. You know, just like the Apostle Paul, everywhere he went, he started revival or riot. And if you want to maintain peace, you have to call things the way they are. You can't fall into the political correctness that is in our nation today. We got to constantly stamp on the PC police. And we have to tell the truth. There is no peace without truth. You know what I'm saying? They marched Jesus to Pilate. In the midst of all that crowd, got a bunch of lying witnesses together who wasn't even telling the truth. All the witnesses didn't collaborate. The stories were not collaborated. And they had truth standing right in the middle of them, and there was no peace. Why? Because they didn't believe in truth that was right in front of them. Pilate asked the question, what is truth? Well, he was looking at it. and because of the warning of his wife, who had a dream about this righteous man, brought the fear of the Lord on him. Amen. He struggled, you know the story. He struggled to release him. But the lack of peace was all around him. They wanted his blood. I'm glad they killed him. How many of you glad? How many of you glad they killed him? I'm talking about Jesus. How many of you glad? How many of you glad? Come on, that's not a trick question. Say yeah. How many of you glad? You wouldn't be sitting here tonight if you would, if he wasn't. He surrendered his life, not his peace. He would have not been able to do what he did if he lost his peace. How did he maintain his peace? Look what he said in the garden. I don't want to do this. It was not death that he was afraid of. For this cause I came. It was the separation from peace that caused him to fear. See, you don't understand that. The unbeliever doesn't understand that. Because even standing on this earth, not knowing Jesus, they still sense the peace and presence of God because his spirit is everywhere. Brother, sister, his spirit is not in hell. His spirit knows everything that goes on in hell. His spirit sees everything that is in hell. But his presence and peace and character is not in hell. It is void of that place. And they are in 24-hour horror because they cannot feel, sense, know, or see the presence of peace. God. Amen. Now Jesus turned around and you might not be serious about it, but he is. Jesus is serious about duplicating himself on the inside of you. He's serious about it. And there is no piety in you thinking or saying, well, I'm just me. Well, Jesus knows that. That's why he's trying to make you him. With your character intact, with your personality, not your character, but your personality intact, Jesus wants to bring who you really are to the forefront. And it can only be done in Christ. Amen. In Christ. So one of these foundational things that must flow through your life, just like the river that flows from the throne of God, and there's tributaries that goes out from that river. Imagine that those streams are the nine fruits of the Spirit. But it comes from one main source. It is fed from one main source, and that is love. But the one thing that God needs you to be is a peacemaker. Brother, sister, listen. Peace has been taken from the earth. And the peacemakers must arise. Huh? Now watch this. It is the peacemakers, and it's interesting, doctrine of the Beatitudes, one of the truths that's put forth, the end result is the culmination of that truth, right? Of the doctrine of the Beatitudes. Notice how he connects. They shall be called the sons of God to the peacemakers. And that's not by chance. Notice the connection of each one. With each doctrinal truth, there is a culmination of that truth. Right? Right? Y'all looking at me like, yeah, y'all just lost your place in the Bible. Right? Come on, somebody say right. Let me give you an example. Remember the one we just did. Blessed are the pure in heart, found. foundation of truth. What is the culmination of it? For they shall see God. See? And you should know, you should understand that even more with the teaching that we've been doing on restoring the soul. The more God can purify the veil, remove the veil, and that's restoring your soul, guess what? The clearer you can see, right? It's kind of like the story. I was looking at a movie one night in the bed. I'm shaking, baby, and I was laughing so hard. What you looking at? How many have seen the story? My friend Benny, or Benny, huh? Yeah, the little guy. And that's the title? Benny, my friend Benny. My cousin Benny. How many seen that? My cousin Benny. Come on, I know you watch TV. But see, when you miss them comedies, you miss most of your life. Where y'all been? You know? And then they have the judge sitting up there, and he's from you know, he's Lurch, you know, what's the old movie? The Monsters. You remember the old song, The Monsters? The Monster Man, you know, where the song come from? Well, you know, tall guy, looked like about 9 feet tall, but anyway, his name was Lurch, but he was the judge. So Benny, crazy, all get out. So he's talking along, and he said, "Ye two youths," and he said, "Say what?" He was trying to say, "Youths." Y-O-U-T-H. And he said, "Did you say youth?" He said, "Youth." He said, "What's a youth?" See, you don't appreciate the fun as y'all to see the movie. All y'all just, anyway. But anyway. Now, why did I even get off on that? I was trying to make a point. What was that? See, if y'all was going with me, was laughing, I wouldn't even forgot my point. But but anyway, and it was a good point too. I hate something that. See, when I go out trying to explain something, I just lose everything. Anyway, I'm just gonna leave y'all in the dark now. But anyway, my point is this. Let's go back to my point I was making, and it's very important. When you talk about, I got it now. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Well, anyway, there was these young boys that they were saying that committed murder. And so all of the witnesses, they were so sure, you know, that they were right. And one by one, he just debunked the witnesses. Okay? One guy came up there, and he said, "Now, you sure you saw these two youths?" Then he looked at the judge and says, "These two defendants, it was them." He said, "Yeah, I'm sure." And so he got these pictures. He said, "What is this?" He said, "That's the bush." He said, "What is this?" He said, "That's my glass." He said, "What's that stuff on the glass?" Dirt. So he got all this dirt on his point was, he got all this dirt on his glass. You can't see it. He got all these bushes, everything. And you said you saw these two defendants. Are you sure? Well, maybe it could have been somebody. It could have been somebody. Here's my point. Anyway. Being purified is kind of the same way. When your soul is dirty by things of the past, it's just like wearing dog glasses. Or wearing glasses got a bunch of scratches and dirt on it. And you take them to your eye doctor said, "I need new glasses. These things, I can't see out of them. My eyes is changing." And the doctor looked at it, takes his thing and sprinkles some stuff on and put it on. You go, "Ooh, you gave me new glasses, doctor. He said, "No, dummy, I just cleaned them." See, this is what God is doing with our soul. It's purifying our soul. The end result is what? You can see God. This is literally, this is not figurative. Because remember, your soul wraps around your spirit. And your spirit sees through the contamination of what's in your soul. You know what I'm saying? It's just like if you had an embarrassed, bad experience with a man. And it's traumatic, dramatizing, and it created a stumbling block in your life. Guess what? You're going to live your life through every man from that place. There's those bad glasses that are on. Life has covered your eyes when it comes to men. That's just an example. But that's the way life is in everything. So Jesus comes along and does what? He restores your soul in that area. And guess what? All men are not dogs. You get that revelation? Because some of them got a tail, not all of them. At least you women should have. Anyway, so let's go on. So this is my point. You have a doctrinal truth and you have a culmination. So interesting enough, the writer tells us the peacemakers, the culmination of being a person of peace, brings you to sonship. Sonship. Why? Because if all the characters and the foundation of principles, this is the one that gives you the stature and the character of the Son. Jesus came to break down the wall of what? Division, enmity between God and man. He was called by the angels the Prince of what? Peace. It is an honor that comes from God only, like a cloak, like a knighthood, one of peace. When you are carrying that for the king, you are representing the king in a way, amen, that you can speak for him, that you can release things for him. See, it is a sonship statue. Y'all understand what I'm saying to you? The peacemaker. So this is not something that you can lay down or overlook or miss in your pursuit of God. Amen? Now, you know as well as I do. For instance, what, not too long ago, Queen Elizabeth announced that not Charles, but his son would come into the kingship. We don't know what kind of flack Charles gave, but you know he'd been groomed by royalty enough to keep his opinion to himself. Though, you know, fully, you know, though he's a young man, but he have not stepped in that office, but guess what? All the honor, even though the queen is still alive, all the honor, the statue, you know, the glory of kingship is where? On this young man. And now he is being groomed as such. So you need to understand, this is what the enemy sees in the realm of the spirit. Amen. Even though he know that you have not attained or earned it, but he's going to respect it. Or he's going to try to disprove it, but he's going to respect it. Because he don't know at any time when the king will step up on the inside of you and smack him. But he also understands the principle of the kingdom. You have to walk and talk to part. Amen. Even though the part is not fully formed in you yet. That's not fronting. That's faith. Come on. That's faith. The Bible said, let the weak say, I'm strong. That's not fronting it. That's faith. And when you say it, and the devil looks in the spirit and see weakness and not strongness, then guess what? When he run up against it, he's going to run up against strongness, because he's going to run right smack dead into your angel that's coming for your words, even though, amen, there may be weakness there. But you're declaring that you're strong. Well, that's the principle of the kingdom. That's how the kingdom works. Amen. So, Jesus goes on to say, they shall be called the sons of God. Now, we know there's a combination of that. That's where this is taking you to. So, this scripture indicates, peacemaker then is a person who has received a certain level of maturity in God. Amen. So the term son of God, is used in the scripture to describe a person who has become a fully mature son of God. So Jesus is telling you, on your road to sonship, you cannot not abandon your duty as a peacemaker, or you will not get there. You will not get there. All right? Now, the Greek word for son here is hubs, H-U-I-O-S, and it means fully matured son. Fully matured son. Guess what? I had five boys. Now, technically, you all call them my son, but guess what? Five-year-old, you're not fully mature, right? 10-year-old, you're not fully mature, right? But there was a day that they were fully matured sons. Brother, sister, God needs now more than ever sons. Amen. You need sons. You say, well, I thought you said that he was going to win the war with you. He is. But he needs the Joshuas, amen, to be a guiding light and to teach the youth. God still needs sons. Come on. In this place called Alaska, this hunting person's paradise, don't no father in his right mind pulls his shotgun out of the cabinet and gives it to his 10-year-old and says, go out in the woods and learn how to shoot. Well, guess what? He might turn around and a bullet come through the house and blow his head off trying to learn how to shoot. No father does that in his right mind. What does he do? He go out in the woods with his son, take him through the uses of safety, how to do this, how to clean a rifle, how to get it, how to aim, how to do all that stuff, right? Until he is a fully matured son and he can do it on his own. Now, this is what God is trying to do. But his people, his children, want to stay children. They don't want to grow up. Amen. The end results of that is paradise is full. Where is paradise? It's the outer court of heaven. It is full of children. They did not mature. God tried his best to get them to mature. Just like he tried his best to get Israel into the promised land. Spiritually, they would not mature. They would not listen to him. He had to discard. He waited for their children. Now you know as well as I do spiritually that is exactly what has happened to the church. That's exactly what has happened. This is where we are now in God's time frame. Most of the children that God will use, the millennials, are out in the streets acting fools and wanting their rights. Amen. I am glad that God is going to awaken them and move the veil off their eyes. And in a flash, they're going to see the King. Amen. They're going to see the King. But guess what? But in his kingdom, they must still be brought sons. They must be brought to the Joshuas, right? Because it's the Joshuas that have the instructions on how God will bring victory to his kingdom. It was Joshua that was given the revelation, march around one time every day and then on the 7 day, seven times. It was Joshua, not the young army. See, God still needs his son. Time to grow up. It's time to grow up. So, when God said of Jesus, you know the story, this is my son, everyone who heard this knew what it meant. It referred to the Jewish custom of placing a son. You know, you read your Bible all the time. Romans chapter 5 talked about the adoption. Now, this literally happens in Jewish custom. Look at Matthew chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3, verse 17. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved son in whom I well pleased. I might point out to the fact that many thought it thundered. There were some that heard it clearly. To God, he's speaking all the time. Did you know that? And most Christians still think it's ugly because of their lack of maturity. See, this is why God so desperately now, his mandate, I told you the last Sunday, the word of the Lord for this year is restore. God is restoring the souls of his people, and he's going to use them to restore Isaiah, to come bring together the breach that has been created by the enemy, that have disfranchised generationally so many. Amen. Through the curse. You are the restorer of those breaches. You are the restorer that will walk in places, in churches, and look in people's lives and bring the word of the Lord and say, you, because of the curse, this is in your life. And you're going to curse the curse and bring restoration to their life. You are the one, not just preachers. You are the one, what we term the common folk. You are the one that God's going to use to do that. Amen. And brother, sister, that's what it needs to be done. But it needs to be done more so in the church than in the world. Listen, and listen, we also told you, this is what Holy Spirit. So, baby, the other day, this is the prophetic generation. Amen. The prophetic generation that your eyes, remember, again, one of the results of being purified is you being able to see. Your prophetic eyes, like the eagle, becoming sharp. And, brother, sister, you need to get the attitude of you bringing the prophetic word to the lost. If you start speaking to them supernaturally about themselves, they'll listen to you. They will listen to you. Well, this is one of the greatest tools you will have in this restoration, this purifying that God is doing to his church. Amen? See, and so again, what has been the problem? And the reason the Lord has not done a lot of this is because our inability to hear. We have not been able to hear. And then what we do here, we're struggling about, is that God? Is that not? Is that me? We've been all over the place with it. See, the brothers and sisters, the purifying of the soul deals with it. Oh, it deals with it. Amen. So, the writer Matthew says, the voice came, "This is my beloved son of one well pleased." Now, in a Jewish household, the father never calls any of his male children son. In the Orthodox Jewish household, they never call any of the male sons until they reach a certain age. Guess what the age is? 30. Amen. Now, in the bar mitzvah, he enters the training hood of sonship at 13. The training. And then under the watchful eye. Under the watchful eye. So, in essence, Jesus, the Father was saying to all those that were present, he has reached maturity. He is ready to represent the family. He is ready to carry my name. This is what the Father said, and many Jewish people understood that. It's most American Christians. But that's what Paul was talking about in Romans chapter 5 and 6. When he was talking about stewardship, schoolmaster, and all that stuff. Alright? So, when this male child reaches the age of 30, family and friends were called to a ceremony in which the father's male child may be recognized. At the ceremony was often called the placing of a son. Google it. Mr. Google it. So, when the son had been placed in placed his status in the family change, he was given authority to transact business in the father's name. And this is what God was saying. See, God does nothing. Words in Bible is not just there to fill up the pages. There's a spiritual significance there. And when God said this in Matthew 3:17, this is what he was saying concerning Jesus. He was Jewish, right? So he was following Jewish customs. All right? So when God said, this is my son, he was placing his son and giving him great authority to transact business in the father's name. So this is the kind of person that Jesus is talking about in Matthew 5 and 9. The peacemaker has become a mature son. He's releasing what the Father is giving. He's told to surrender his, what he thinks about, his attitude of motive. He's surrendering it to the Father. He knows the Father. He knows his ways. He knows his heart. Huh? Do you know, even today, rich people, a lot of them, don't turn their business over to their children who are worthless. They won't do it. But if the children who they turn them over to, they know that father. They know his ways. They know how he thinks. They know his attitude. A perfect example. Matter of fact, thank the Holy Spirit. That's what the Holy Spirit just said. Everybody's been talking about Trump kids. Now, I hear them been saying about the model citizen. And it is the reason why God chose him. And it's the reason why his family is the way they are. They are the model. They are the model. They are the model for the church. And their children is the model for what God is doing right now. Trump ain't got no problem turning his business over to his children because they just like him. He has taught them well on how to think, what to do. They've been around him. And that's exactly spiritually what God is getting ready to do in the church. There's always spiritual significance in something that God does naturally. You hear what I'm saying to you? Getting ready to turn over his business to his children. God is getting ready to do the exact same thing to him. There are those that God is getting ready to put the finishing touches on. And these, those, he are calling peacemakers. Amen. We will bring peace everywhere we go. Now listen. The kingdom of God is not interested in establishing a kingdom physically on this earth. Our responsibility is to bring peace in the lives of people where there is turmoil. Amen? This is where we are interested in bringing the kingdom inside of people. Amen. So, what am I saying? So, if you want to attain this status, one of the requirements is to be. What is a peacemaker? Because we live in a very troubled world. People are troubled, fearful, about so many changes, the size in which we live, everything. But conducive to peace and tranquility. It's not that. And it will get worse. It will get worse. Countless millions of tranquilized. You know one of the biggest pills that are being pushed now is anxiety. That's the inability to maintain control. Brother, sister, the reason that is increasing because you can chart that by the level of darkness that has been released in the land. Those are spirits. And it will get worse. I'm telling you, it will get worse. And there is no reason for Christians to be popping pills, talking about, I gotta get calm. Where is the peace? Where is Jesus in the middle of all this? Come on. We're the answer. We're the peacemaker. We're the ones that will put the drug companies out of business with their pills of anxiety. Everywhere Jesus walked, he brought peace because he dealt with demons that brought fear, trouble, and everything else. Amen. Mark 16 says, one of your responsibilities is to cast out devils. Those that believe. So you deal with the issue of believing, but that's another message. So anyway, if you're to bring priests and trouble lives, it's going to cost you. I mean, what's it going to cost? Look at Leviticus chapter 3. There are stories all over in the Bible that extrapolated, bring spiritual truth to everything that Jesus said in the New Testament and the apostles as well. So in Leviticus chapter 3, 1 through 5, got a description of what is called the peace offering. This describes what an Israelite had to do in order to have peace. All right? That's what it's called, the peace offering. See, an offering had to be brought to the Lord. This involves sacrifice on the part of the person bringing the offering. It costs him something. That's why David made statements sometimes. I will not give God that which costs me nothing. You got Christians all the time want to do something that don't cost you. What's it going to cost you? Amen. If it costs them something, they don't want to do it. A lot of things you decide to do, you got to see the godness in it. Because God may be behind. So an offering had to be brought to the Lord. This involves sacrifice on the part of the person bringing the offering. Cost him. Verse 2. Look at before we get to chapter 3. Look at 2 and verse 16. The priest shall burn the memorial of it, part of the beaten coin thereof, part of the oil thereof, with all of the frankincense thereof. It is an offering made by fire unto the Lord. All right, now flip over chapter 3, look at verse 1. And if this oblation is a sacrifice of peace offering, if he offer it of the herd, whether it be male or female, he shall offer it without blemish before the Lord. Now that immediately just set off all kinds of sickness. Can't have imperfections. All right? Verse 2. And he shall lay his hand, the priest, shall lay his hand upon the head of his offering and kill it at the door of the tabernacle. Everybody said, kill it. You know where I'm going, right? And kill it at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. Aaron's sons, the priest, shall sprinkle the blood upon the altar round about. And he shall offer of the sacrifice of the peace offering, an offering made by fire unto the Lord, the fat that covered the inwards, and all the fat that is upon the inwards, and the two kidneys. You need to underline that. The two kidneys and the fat that is upon them, which is by the flanks, and the caul upon the liver with the kidneys, and it shall he take away. And Aaron's son shall burn it on the altar upon the burnt sacrifice, which is upon the wood that is on the fire. It is an offering. Now remember, everything God does has purpose, right? So, let's look at two main ingredients used in the offering. The fat of the animals. Most people today don't eat the fat. Fat. And the kidneys. So, now Now, the picture is very interesting. The details, which often are given in Scripture, are not, as I say all the time, it's not just a few pages. But what we do as Christians, we read over stuff, oh, what the heck? And then we just keep on reading until we get to something that means something to us. Huh? And most of the time you miss the most important part, the part you don't understand. So the details, which are given in Scripture, not just fear, they often have profound, profound meaning. Fat, in symbolic terms, is the word speaks of strength. If you take the fat, a lot of the fat out of your body that's around joints, guess what? You'll lose a lot of strength. A lot of strength. I'm talking about in your own body. So fat in symbolic terms in the word speaks of strength. The kidney is another story. The kidneys are an unusual symbolic picture depicting the controlling element of our lives. All right? Everybody say kidney. All right? The controlling element of our lives. Now, this word, the kidney, goes back to the Hebrew concept of the heart, okay? Which today we say the heart to control our life because it beats the blood, right? Well, the kidneys from the inaccessible place in the body were regarded by the early Hebrews as the seat of the emotions, okay? Right. When that angel came many, many years ago and stuck his hands into me spiritually, that's where he stuck it. All right? So, it was the Bible translators. So I told you it's the hidden emotions, right? The hidden inner part of the man, emotion, seat of emotion. That's what the old Hebrews called the kidney. So, the Bible translators had real trouble translating this into meaningful English word. They finally came up with the English word reins. R-E-I-N-S. That's what they use in the translation. Substituting the word kidneys for reins. This they felt made the meaning much clearer. But in actuality, they really damaged it. That's what they did. Because we looked at it in December day. Well, that don't mean anything. Now, real quickly, Psalm 7:9. Trip over there. Psalms chapter 7, verse 9. The psalmist said, oh, let the wickedness of the wicked come to an end, but establish the just for the righteousness. God tries the heart and the reins. And it's actually supposed to be the kidneys. But that didn't make sense. Hey, look at it. What is God doing with your kidneys? No, that don't make sense. Let's get another word for that. Right? That's what they did. So the word reins in this verse is, again, the word kidneys. The translators could not bring themselves to translate it as the Lord tried to kidney. It sounds like the Lord trying to make you pee, huh? So they changed it. Anyway, come on, y'all. Get a sense of humor. So as it would not convey the real meaning of the concept of the word, right? Now, again, look at Psalms 139 real quick. 139 verse 13. For thou hast possessed my reins. Now, what does God want with your kidney? So reins, you know, like reins on a horse. Ugh. And so they figured, well, same concept, you know, that's what they figured. Controlling the horse, right? All right. Thou hast covered me in thy mother's womb. So if you see the word kidney, it makes more sense, right? You cover me in my mother's womb, right? So the word is carried over into the New Testament. Now look at Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, verse 23. And I will cure her children with death, talking about Jezebel, and all the churches shall know that I am he which searches the reins and heart, is the word kidney. And I will give unto every one of you according to your works. All right? So, the word kidneys used in the peace offering represents, listen, human desires. Human desires. Man's will. The controlling factor in one's life. Why do you do what you do? This is why God so desperately wants to restore your soul. Okay? You know, just as a horse, remember again, I use the analogy a little while ago, just as a horse controlled by the reins, so that part of our lives has to be offered to the Lord. You have to offer it to Him. You have to offer it to Him. Do you see what I'm saying? It's a peace offering. You have to bring it to Him. He will not take it. You have to offer it to Him. So, what am I saying? To have peace, you have to hand over the reins of our lives to the Lord. You have to. You know why a lot of Christians don't have peace in the church today? They're not in the will of God. They're not doing what God called them to do. They're not being what He created them to be. All of that is the reins of your life. You don't know it's not an excuse. Because God has given you all the tools to find out. He told you, you draw near to me, I'll draw near to you. If you ask me, I will answer you. I will respond to you. There is no excuse. As I said before, God is always speaking. Always. Question is, are you on the right channel? And even if you are you hearing what you want to hear? That's a lot of questions with a lot of Christians. That ain't what I want to hear. I don't want to do that. Come on. Some people think so much of themselves in their life, in their call, in their profession, and everything else, they would not dare leave it for God. I'm going to tell you, there's a whole lot of Christians going to lose their lives when God, listen, brother, sister, this is not in my message, but I need to throw this in. Do you see what's happening in America today? One thing that was very significant, you hear the news media, they're always talking about the natural. Oh, this election is so polarized, it's so this, that. It was so divisive, so this, that, that. Everybody got their natural analogy. Well, step back, Christians, and look at spiritually what was going on. First of all, God exposed everybody. What people were really made of, what really mattered to them, came out during this election. And from this election, I tell you, you had family members mad at other family members, cussing other family members out. I mean, you see the divisiveness in the street, people being beat up just because of the sides that they took. And one thing that's being brought up about the left, they have no tolerance whatsoever. They are being exposed for what they are. Speaking, just conversing, you know, bringing an argument to the table. It's no longer relative. Shut you down. You ain't nothing because you don't believe what I believe. This is what is being done. So the people are really exposing themselves. Those who really, really have no opinion, those who are kind of who are living in the gray, they are seeing the intolerance of those who have been either far left or far right. I hate terminology like that, but, you know, they give people's labels. But you got to use them to identify what you're saying. So what is happening? What is happening? God has forced, something I've been saying for the last couple of years, God is forcing people to choose. He's forcing change. That's what He's doing. And sooner or later, brother, sister, it's going to be either left or right. And there's going to be no in between. None. Whatsoever. So people are showing what they really are. And in all of this that's taking place, God is going to need people of truth. Truth. Amen. And so you got, did you see the governor of California? Did you see the demonic, this demon spirit that's in this guy's eyes. I mean, he's standing up there behind the podium. We're going to do this in government, and we're going to defy the federal government. And I don't care what, we're going to California, we're going to be the first to stand up, and we're going to set a precedent, and that's exactly why it's going to fall in the ocean. It's exactly why. They do not know that they are resisting Almighty God, but they are doing it at a bad, bad time. God is drawing the line. This is why he said several years ago, it is so important now, local government is so important now, from governors to mayors. God is making a divide now. And this is why, listen, you watch him do it. Trump mandate now will be pushing everything back to the control of the states. And when the states have power, brother, sister, now it will determine what state will be destroyed, what city will be destroyed. You watch all of these little 200 and something counties. It was 300 and something counties that stood up and defied. We're going to do what we're going to go. We're going to have sanctuary cities. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. You watch when God start telling his people, get out of that city. Get out of that state. Get out. Because when it comes to the place that he can't help it, he will destroy it. God follows his own principles. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. If it's going to defile the rest of the country, he will destroy it and wipe it out. He told you to do that yourself. If your eye offend you, pluck it out. And this is what he's getting ready to do. Brothers and sisters, this is where it's all headed. The divide. Don't be caught on the wrong side. Do not be caught on the wrong side. It will be judged. We've had time now to judge ourselves. The nation. Individual cities and states have time to judge themselves. Now, God is going to judge. That's what is happening now. And that's why he's raising up peacemakers, those who are full of peace. Because he's going to send you to places. He's going to send you to cities, and he's going to call them out. Amen. Call them out. And when many people, just like it was in Jonah's day, and many people, when many people of God go into a place and say, you have such and such a time to do this. If you do not do it, this will happen. Listen, a lot of that's going to be televised on TV all around the world. The peacemakers are going to tell them and bring judgment. And if they do not do it, they will see the end results. Huh? The sons of God. Tell you, it's going to happen. So, Romans 14. Turn it real quick. So, remember I said now, to have peace, we have to hand over the reins of our lives to God, right? The second ingredient of the peace offering was fat. Remember? Fat. As I said before, fat represents strength. So the Israelites had to bring a sacrifice and offer the kidneys, reins, and the fat. Strength. Takes a lot of fat, right? Strength to hand over the kidneys, the reins of our lives. So one of the main aspects of the kingdom of God is peace. Chapter 14, verse 17. For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, which some people think that's what it is in heaven. I get to heaven, all I do is play harp, drink, have fun. No, that's not the kingdom. The kingdom of God, not meat and drink, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Why are you going to need so much joy in these coming days? Listen, this year, 2017, the joy of God is going to increase on the inside of his people to such a level. And when it does, it will start restoring your physical body. It will start renewing your youth as the eagle. Amen. That's what the joy of the Lord does. Why is that so desperately needed? Because all of the death and dying that's going to be around you. See? You're going to have to be stabilized by the joy of the Lord. Because in your heart, you're going to be broken. It's going to tear you on the inside. But you cannot be moved by your emotions. You cannot bring life to something that God has decreed death to. You cannot do it. So you need the joy of God flooding your veins, through your veins. You need the peace of God upon you, even when you decree death to an entire village or an entire city. You cannot do that without the presence of God. Huh? Can't do it. Are you going to do what King Saul did? You know what got him rejected? Well, I kept the animals to sacrifice unto the Lord. And you kept the king alive. Well, the people did it. That wasn't the time to be compassionate. God said, kill everything. He did. Samuel took the sword and right there killed the king before everybody. Huh? And stripped the kingdom from Saul. See, this is not the time to have things stripped from you, because you get humanly, emotionally involved. That's why you need the peace and the joy of God running through your veins, sustaining you, not allowing you to be moved emotionally. Come on. Now, because a lot of the rest of the church is going to be moved that way, not his sons. Amen. Verse 19. Let us therefore follow after the things which make for peace, and things wherewith one may edify another. I flip back over to Psalm 34:14 again. Depart from evil. Depart from evil. And do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Pursue it. See, there's another lesson in the scripture where it tells you this vernacular. When the Bible uses certain vernacular about certain things, you need to stop and meditate on it. He tell you to pursue peace, but he told you to walk in love. Pursue. Pursue. So, we can only bring or minister to others what we are. Can't give what you don't have. We must become peace before we can bring it. It is a presence of the character of God that is tangible to you and in the natural world. So, as we die to ourselves, handing over the reins of our lives to God, we begin to enter into peace. As you die to yourself, handing over the reins of your life to God, you are in pursuit of peace. You enter into it. That's why you have to pursue it. Hence is the challenge of the human psyche. Handing over their life to an unseen spirit. And the excuse that I don't know is not an excuse. And without the ingredients of peace, you will never know sonship. Ever. Ever. Especially this last generation, us, to whom the ends of the world have come. Amen. So when we are no longer our own, we are in the hands of God. And it does not matter what happens to us. So my question is to you tonight. Do you care about what happens? Do you care about what other people think about you? Do you care about what other people say about you? You don't have control of your life. Once you enter this place in God, everything changes. Your whole outlook on life is transformed. It's no longer you that live. Does it sound like Paul? The enemy does not know how to handle a person who has entered into peace, because nothing can affect them. They cannot be bought. They cannot be sold. They're not a charlatan. They don't care about recognition for a name. The biggest problem in the church today, the Babylonian spirit, to make a name for itself. They don't care. They don't care about who gets the credit. All they're interested in is that Jesus be exalted. That's all they're interested in. And that is not what happened to them. The only person, the only thing the devil can really do to a peacemaker is kill him. Kill him. That's what he did to the apostles. Kill him. That's the only way. You know, they didn't care. They stood right face to face, toe to toe with the people that killed Jesus and said, beat me, do whatever you want to. But we can only do what we have seen and heard. So they threatened him, said, don't preach no more that name. Did they stop him? No. So their only recourse is to kill you. You cannot be a peacemaker and love your life. Because at any time, you would have to lay it down. But you don't have to worry about laying it down. Because they can't take it if Jesus don't call it. They can't take it. Well, I know. I hear you. Because I tell Jesus the same thing. No, I'm not in the pain. Kill me quickly. Well, it doesn't matter. He wasn't either. But guess what? 39 strikes. Boom, boom, boom. How many of you seen Passion of Christ. How many see? Well, you know, the Lord told one prophet it was worse than that. Now, they didn't beat him all over the place. Only 39 strikes. 39. But Isaiah looked back into the future and said, his vengeance was so long. Who designed it? Well, Jesus is the most beautiful man on the planet. But when they got through with him, Isaiah said, who designed it? And I guarantee you, God didn't take away the pain. Now, is he worth getting you getting your little feelings hurt? We can't get past our feelings getting hurt. Let's know talking about being slapped in the face, being spit on. You ain't dead yet. You have not turned the reins. Listen, this brings fantastic relief and qualifies the person as a truly mature son of God. Everywhere these people go, they will bring peace. Everywhere. Just like in these coming days, as gross darkness covers the earth, the only light around will be on this world. Can you imagine? You'll be the most hated person on the planet, but the most loved when you show up because you will bring his presence with you. Brother and sister, as it gets darker, just by default, you get light, right? You take the mall, the smallest light, you know, in the natural into the darkest room. It throws off some light, right? In the same way. It is in the kingdom. Yes, God would always have different levels of light. Always. But I'm telling you right now, he needs now more than ever sons. And this is his objective. This is what drives him now. His sons. He cannot begin to do what he desired to do in his last day without sons. He can't do it all with just babies. Because when babies get through, then they go play. Yeah, they go play. He needs sons. Proverbs 13:10. This is very interesting. Look at it. You know, so much of it, and I saw a lot of it in the 80s when I was a pastor. Because I could visit churches a lot. I don't get a chance to do that now, so I don't know about now. But so much of the so-called, you know, conflict management in the church today is based in humanism and psychology. Resolving conflicts require that at least, listen, resolving conflicts, especially in a marriage, resolving conflicts requires at least one of the parties involved have to die. I'm not talking about physically. You guns at one another. One has to die. One has to surrender. Proverbs 13:10. Look what. Only, now you need to get this. You need to literally swallow this. Here's a spiritual formula. Only by pride cometh contention. Now put that on your refrigerator. Only by pride cometh contention. So if you swallow your pride, contention leaves. Right? But with the well advised is wisdom. With the well advised is wisdom. So when two parties are in contention, one party has to submit. That's what I mean by that. If the situation is agreed upon. Right? If y'all never been in contention. Are y'all peacemakers? Oh, okay, I'm preaching to the wrong crowd. Now, this does not mean we have to submit to evil. That's not what I'm saying. Submission is primarily an attitude. You know, you have to know you're not losing. Because you're submitting, you're not losing. You're the stronger of the two, not the weaker. The world has told us we are the weaker of the two. You're not waving your arms like a windmill and spitting cotton. Matthew 11, that scripture. I'm done. Matthew 11. So, the gospel of the kingdom is not one of receiving what is rightfully mine. Because that's what we raise. That's why we're taught. And when we come into the kingdom, say, abase. Don't abow. Humble. Don't exalt. Huh? And there's nothing wrong with that. You tell our kids, yeah, you're wonderful, you're great, you're all this and you're all that and a piece of cake, and you should tell them that. They lift our self-esteem. But real self-esteem comes from Jesus Christ. You don't care the heck what anybody thinks about you. Tell them what he thinks. Huh? Because he's the only one got a heaven or hell to put you in. That's what he said. He's the only one that can destroy the soul. So, it is giving up your rights that you may receive his life, passing through death and awakening through resurrection. That's the kingdom. That brings peace in every situation. So, if you want to enter the realm of heaven and you're there to walk with the Lord, a realm of peace that passes all understand, where nothing can disturb you, you have to, you got to bring a peace offering. Now, in your walk with God, in your pursuit of God, you will come face to face in situations and circumstances in the midst of tests where God show you what you're really made of. And he's asking you, in the test, he's saying to you, bring that to me. That's a peace offering. That which has been a part of you for so long that has made you who you are. But it is an enemy to the cross. And that's very hard to lay down. Because that's what has made you who you are for so long. But it's an enemy to the cross. You've been saying to him, sanctify it. No, Lord, don't take it. Sanctify it. Sanctify it. In other words, use it. No, he said, I want to kill it. I don't want to sanctify it. I want to kill it. Bring it. A peace offering. Why is it a peace offering? Because it will bring peace to you. So now you can see why many Christians have not unloaded the very things that's killing them. They have not unloaded. They have not given it to God. They have not given it to God. Huh? Because just like in the natural, You know, when I was little, during the time when I was in school, when the teacher gave the test, if I wasn't ready, I skipped class. And it's like a lot of Christians are doing today. They want to skip. They want to skip the test. We'll keep skipping. That's why a lot of you are still in the first grade, spiritually. Thing about God's test, you don't flunk them, you just keep taking them. You got to keep taking them in order to get promoted. And you ain't not going to make it as a Christian without the element of peace. And you're not going to get peace unless you defy what is stealing your peace. Now. Huh? Amen. Matthew 11:29. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. Now this is similar to what we've been doing. We've been laying out the principles of the kingdom. Laying out before you now how to become a son by pursuing peace. Now it's up to you to do it. But you got to take his yoke, his mindset, what's important to him. Right? We've learned in retrospect of peace. He told you, I'm meek and lowly at heart. That simply means I'm not going to force you. I'm not going to make you. But I will help you. I will help you. I've been where you've been, and I've overcome. And you will find rest for. Notice where it comes back to. Rest for your soul. Notice where it comes back to. Because that's where the contention is. That's where the problem is. In the soul. He wants to restore it tonight. And one of the key elements of the foundation and principles of your life is you must pursue peace. You must. Now, again, it's not some abstract thing where you're running around in the people individually and saying, is this peace? Should I do this? Should I do that? That's maybe a part of it. But guess what? You're not going to discern what that is if your soul, amen, has not been delivered from that which is not peace. That's why he wants to restore. So that's why you got to work with him, amen, as he exposes stuff in your life. As he exposes stuff in your life, then you got to bring him a peace offering. You got to put it on the altar. When you do, in the process of peace, to deliver peace to you, where this contention is, has been, will abound. Now from that place, after being delivered from contention, because where that contention is, there's pride. Because when he shows you what you look like, you're going to guarantee up and down he got it wrong. Huh? Amen. Lord, that can't be me, Lord. That can't be me. I only acted like that because what they did. That's what you tell God in your psyche. And God will tell you, they ain't got nothing to do with it. This is you. Give it to me. Bring the peace offering. Lay it on the altar. That's pursuing peace. Allowing God to devastate you. Allowing God to break you. Because he's allowing you to be walked on by the enemy. He is allowing you to be broken. He is allowing that which is not like him to be exposed. He's allowing the fragrance, the stinkiness of that to come out. He's allowing it. Now guess what? We all smell it, but you don't. It smells good to you because it's coming from you. But it all stink to us. And if we are peacemakers, if we are children of the light, amen, we got to get, I'm talking about we now, all of us, you know, that may not interact with you all the time or may not be a part, amen, of the formula of your exposure. But we as good Christians, amen, as potential sons, we have to do what? We have to lay down our life as well. We have to give you room to stink. You understand my lingo? We have to give you room to stink. Not trying to point out what you are and what you look like, because you know. Unless you got the anointing of the Lord, you got the oil of the Lord upon you to walk up to your brother and your sister and say, come on, come on. You know this is wrong. Come on. Huh? That's bearing one another's burdens. Come on. Now, you don't have to point out to someone burden to let them know you're bearing it. God might want you to bear it in your prayer closet. Well, whatever Holy Spirit leads you to do, do it. But in the meantime, just like the Lord smells us when we stink, and he is long-suffering. You know, that's one of the fruit of the Spirit. The ones were those that's further down the line, right? Being long-suffering. Huh? Now, it's obvious when you're acting a fool, because it's obvious when you're showing it, right? But sometimes it's not so obvious. Some of us are covert, you know. I know. I'm talking to another group. I know y'all don't know what I'm talking about. Who I'm talking about. Anyway, but you know, we're covert with it. You know, we come and we kill 1,000 souls in our mind. We lay you wasted, you know, in our eyes and all that stuff. You know, so we're covert with it. But then there are those times when we're very obvious with it. We roll your eyes and look at you, and dare you look at us again. You know, we do all that other stuff. But just like God is long-suffering with us, he gives us space again to stink. Then, you know, you got to do whatever you got to do. Pull out your perfume, stick it up your nose, whatever you need to do. Oh, here's a good one. Here's a good one. Think about yourself when someone else is going through. Think about the next time you need mercy and grace. Huh? Then you start dropping your stone. Blessed are, we did with that one. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. See, next time you don't get mercy, stop and think about when you was thinking if you gave it. It may be a process you reaping what you sow. Come on, stand. I can keep meddling, but I'm done. Hallelujah. Come on, just lift our hands and thank God for his word. Father, we just thank you tonight. You said it is more blessed to give than to receive. When we give of ourselves, when we give of our time, when we give of our talent, especially when we give our emotions to someone who do not deserve it, we are in pursuit of. We are humbling ourselves before the mighty hand of God. We are setting ourselves up for divine intervention, for blessing. Lord, you want to grow us up so quickly. You have so much to do and such a short time to do it. That's why we have crossed the demarcation line. And that's why so many now, you cannot accomplish in this time frame in church history what you need to do in many lives, because they have not come far enough yet. But there are those who have prepared themselves. There are those who are ready to fall on the rock. There are those that now you can put the finishing touches on, as your word declares, come to your house suddenly. And just by your divine presence, fire, light, and love will burn the residue will burn from all the inward parts that which clings to us, simply because we have done the necessary work to let it go. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for what is about to be revealed. For those you are about to bring out of hiding. For those you are about to exalt. Because they have allowed as much as necessary of Jesus to spring forth in their lives. That you have the reins of their heart because Jesus is in control. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Oh, hallelujah. We long await, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. We long await for the Son.